Hi, I'm EmceeProphIt, and I'm still alive, and so are you. And we both deserve a better world than this. Might not always feel like you deserve better, but you do. And if you're watching this and you're just kinda managing to hold on for now, just hanging on, you should be proud of yourself. Might be stronger than you gave yourself credit for. And that's true for me, too. My future has never been less certain or less safe. I'm disabled in several ways, I have less money than ever, I don't really know what I'm gonna do about this webcam, for instance. I have a lot of trauma and a lot of difficulty from this year to process and overcome, and I feel overwhelmed sometimes. But not all the time. Just sometimes. It's very hard to focus on the positive right now, and really, I feel like we all just need some rest. I need some rest. But the only way that things get better is if everyone does a little bit more good every day. There are things we can't control, but we all have little things that we do control. I can't change the fact that making videos is a lot harder than it used to be for me, but I can continue to heal and learn how to value and take care of myself. I can pursue a beautifully meaningful passion, this channel, because of the kindness of people I don't even know because they think what I do is worth supporting. So when I think about that, it helps me keep going even when things get difficult. And they have been very, very difficult for me this year. So before I get into the video, I want y'all to think about some of the good you've brought into the world, because I've talked with a lot of you, and a lot of you helped me process this year and all the difficult times before it. A lot of you have brought a lot of good to my life, whether you noticed or not. And even if you're the kind of person who just hangs out and comments every now and then, just seeing y'all happy about my streams and videos, or just hearing that I've inspired people to try making their own games. That stuff heals me in a weird way. It feeds my soul to know that I'm making people a little bit happier in my own way. So thank you for that opportunity. It's been the greatest pleasure of my life so far, and I wouldn't trade it for anything. I want to keep doing it, even if it does get hard sometimes. Because at the end of the day, your happiness is valuable and deserved, no matter what anyone says. Okay, let's just talk about video games now. So last time, we talked about the initial inspiration, setting, and character building. That first rush of creativity when developing a game is very important, but now it's time to start getting into some finer detail. Let's flesh out the world, the history, and the setting, and start some real world building. I'd recommend doing this kind of concept work early on as opposed to just making stuff up as you go along. It's helpful to have a very good picture of the geography and history of your world before you start putting ideas to code. I wrote and dreamt of all sorts of adventures in the region of Norrvin before I felt confident putting together any towns or forests in the actual game. I wanted to create a wild, somewhat lonely atmosphere. An expansive valley with a constant storm raging in the distance, a droning rain audible everywhere, muffled when indoors. The rain can be dreary, but the sound can also be somewhat soothing, and it lends the interior spaces a very nice cozy quality. Because of this, the first region of the game can have some decent visual contrast. The interiors will be warm, comfortable, and inviting to contrast the cold, unwelcoming streets and the dank, dark forests. The beginning of the game is gonna be a little sad and lonely as a whole, but I don't want every moment to be dreary, otherwise things will probably get a little bit boring. This opening is about Chandra finding warmth despite the cold, after all. One of my favorite aspects of game development is level design and world building. These terms mean different things, but for a lot of games, they're two sides of the same gill. For example, every RPG worth its salt is going to have treasure for you to find scattered throughout the environment. but how this treasure is implemented can say a lot about the game's tone and setting. In a cartoony, whimsical game like Dragon Quest, it makes sense for chests to basically be everywhere. People's houses, caves that no human being has realistically traveled to in hundreds of years, you know, everywhere. But in games like Dark Souls or Skyrim, dead bodies are used as loot containers fairly often. Looting the corpses of fallen adventurers or warriors of the past has a very different air of macabre danger to it. It's a grim, realistic way of providing loot. For this game, I'm going to leave dead bodies around to serve as foreshadowing for bosses up ahead. A few of them will have loot, and some of them will simply serve as bits of world building. I'll also use more traditional containers where appropriate, and I'm not going to use big flashy treasure boxes anywhere unless it really makes sense for the environment. I also generally want to avoid Chandra stealing from random townsfolk unless they are both very well off and very evil, so most residences aren't going to have loot containers and will instead have books and dialogue to discover. I might even do some side quests. Keeping these little things in mind can do wonders for setting the tone and atmosphere of a game. And it can help build Chandra's character while rewarding the player for exploring thoroughly. The small details are everything when it comes to building a believable atmosphere and world. The Fable of Lashandra is a dark fantasy, and its primary influences are honestly outside of traditional video games. I drew inspiration from actual mythology and superstitions in order to populate the world with engaging mysteries, terrible creatures, and unsettling intrigue. The people of Chandra's world don't understand their world. They're somewhat afraid of it. In ancient times, when wolves, bears, and other powerful predators stalked the woods and could easily overpower humans, folk began to tell their children about horrific monsters glaring with hollow eyes from the shades between the trees. Creatures that would abduct children in the night if they misbehaved or ventured out too far into the forest. And over generations of these stories, these myths slowly became real. The exact nature of why this happens is unknown to the public, but in this world, stories, myths, history, and hysteria have power beyond simple morals, allegory, and paranoia. This setup creates a world not entirely unlike our own. A place that's familiar, but something just seems off. I want to give the player a sense of warm familiarity when relaxing with friendly characters, and a sense of uncertain dread as they walk through the crypts, shaded woods, and eerily empty deserts. For me, world building isn't an exact science, and it's not really something I do the same way twice. In this game, the themes largely revolve around history and how to move on from that history and become a better person, hopefully leading to a better society. A world that's better than the world of your ancestors. Numerous characters and governing bodies are either fighting to preserve history or fighting to spread propaganda that's convenient to their respective nations. People often support these sides without even knowing which side of the conflict they're supporting. I want to make a world that feels like it believably existed before the player hit the start button. A place where there's been a lot of moving parts for quite a while. That's a key part to the illusion of storytelling, especially when you're trying to create an immersive game world. So, let's make a fable. Some people call it a fact, some people call it an idealized myth. And the way certain characters react to this story can say a lot about them, and it'll help us build complex conflicts for the story of the game. Kondake Amani was a warrior queen who united several countries under the Band of Zaret. She's one of the principal characters in the song, The Laying of Arms, which chronicles the peaceful meeting of the Nor and Zareti cultures. Amani led a band of soldiers, hunting local monsters and chronicling their weaknesses and the potential uses of their body parts. At the border of their territory, a Nor hunting party led by Olef the Kind met with Amani's troop. After a moment of tension, both leaders stepped forward, and, almost at the same moment, lay their spears on the ground. Their troops followed suit, and the two began to rejoice and sing, exchanging written records and oral traditions, slowly learning the basics of each other's languages. They sent some of each troop back with the other, beginning the long and fruitful relations between the two cultures. Having a story like this is all well and good, but let's add to this dynamic a bit. Stories can be reinterpreted, censored, or used for nefarious purposes. This is a story that's mostly uplifting and positive and encourages a bond of lasting peace between these two cultures. But what if there's someone who wants to erase that history? They could burn books, they could offer alternative takes on the history, they could create different fables, they could label this factual account of history as a fable. They could slowly start to erase some of the good that this story has done. In reaction to that, some people, regardless of the law, might band together and enforce the idea that these songs are important parts of history and need to be preserved and respected in order to prevent future conflict between the two nations. Adding a simple dynamic like this can really help flesh out a game's world. It makes it feel like this breathing, dynamic place with problems that mirror our own. Obviously, stories and fables are an important theme in this game, but what if a traditional story could be used in a different way? What if there was a fable that told of the most efficient military power in the world, a nation that purged monsters, ended conflicts, and united nations because of the way that they operated? What if that nation used its history of strength as a signifier of their divine right to continue ruling as they have? What if these stories normalize injustice? What if these stories are used to control and guilt people? To treat dissent as a sin that can never be forgiven. And it was thus Lord Casimir did wield his knight as his blade, for a weapon need no will of its own to spill the blood of evil men. This quote has great significance to Chandra. It's a message she internalized from the fables her people all grow up listening to. Some say it's a legend that predates even the first written language. To Chandra, this quote represents fulfilling your function in society. For her entire life, she was just a particularly talented cog in the machine, a living, breathing weapon who must cast aside her own emotions in order to carry out the will of her supposed betters. Chandra never feared death, because the consequence for disobedience was worse than death. If she defied her orders, she always knew that she would be exiled and stripped of her name, legacy, and the impact she had on history. This may seem like a harsh penalty, but this consequence was normalized in her country. It was just something most people accepted. Just like how in Norrevin, malicious forces in the government are trying to normalize the exclusion of foreigners and the practitioners of magic, unless they are already a part of the country's official military. The normalization of evil is a big theme in this game. Can't imagine why I felt inspired to focus on those themes. Every country in the game's setting has its struggles and flaws. I want to portray politics in a realistic fashion, both to flesh out the world and make the storytelling more relatable to the audience. I also want to avoid having one place be overly idealized or completely demonized. A country is just a large group of people who have no choice in where they were born. And among those people, you'll always have outliers and rebels who refuse to accept a morbid status quo. I want the world to feel like it has hope. It's just gonna take a lot of work to make it a good place. Again, I can't imagine what inspired me to focus on these themes. In all seriousness, this game and this video series is pretty much the best thing that 2020 gave me. The Fable of Lashandra has quickly become a major source of passion in my life, and hearing from viewers and playtesters that it's actually inspiring them to get into game design is basically a dream come true for me, so thanks for that. Let me know what you want me to focus on future videos. I already have some more discussion planned on making the opening to the game and introducing the game mechanics to the player, but I'm open to suggestions for other topics. Also, next month I'm probably gonna try doing one of those really long, low editing video essays on a video game that everyone keeps telling me I should do, so there you go. One less thing to bother me about doing, I guess. On a very long list. I feel pretty confident saying that next year is going to be a better one for me personally. I've made a lot of progress on myself these past few months, and as difficult as things are, I just like doing this. I like being alive, making videos, games, and streams, and things for people to look forward to. My topics and schedule are both going to be a little unpredictable for the moment because I'm readjusting to a lot of things, but once things stabilize, I'll be able to look back at all this bullshit as something I managed to overcome. And if this has been a shitty year for you, I hope you can look back on it in a similar way. A difficult time that you overcame. Because you're awesome. And hey, you know who else is awesome? My patrons. They're the only reason I'm alive, and that's pretty cool. I understand times are tight right now, but any support for these videos is extremely appreciated, and you get some cool benefits. If you can't do that, then, I don't know, just comment. Just talk with me, yo. Like, I like talking with y'all. You're very cool people. Check out the Discord and my social media and stuff. I love you. Have confidence in yourself, because you deserve to succeed and grow. Fuck 2020.